So yeah, man, it's the thing is, bro, you have all these keyboard warriors that know what's best. And like Rel said, I don't know the best way. But what I do know is that I will never stay silent about it. And once I can figure out what is the proper action to actually do something productive physical wise, then I will participate in that. I mean, I'm working on some things with the congregation that we're going to do. Because, you know, like we our church, we don't stand by and just allow things to occur. Things in the community as far as giving back, things as far as upholding justice, because we follow the Bible. In the Bible, justice is very clear that justice for the people needs to happen, and people that can't defend themselves, you need to defend them if you can. And, you know, we just, I don't know, man, it's sickening. Like, everybody wants it to be black versus white. And what I feel that happens is a lot of people that are not in our skin, they are arguing to be right about something that doesn't matter, instead of trying to understand the message that we're conveying. Yep.
Funny you know? You say so that. People, not to cut you off, but specifically, Shameik Moore.
Mm-hmm.
Remember we?
Oh, I'm gonna get to him in a minute. But give me a second, bro. Because I was real. I was letting you go. Give me a second, bro.
Because his name so, in my head when you said that. When you said someone specifically speaking just to say something, I was like, that's him.
Disgrace the Raekwon, bro. Disgrace the
Raekwon. Oh, disgrace, bro. And the thing is, like, the problem is we can't take those steps forward, because just like an AA meeting, the first step is admittance. You have to admit that there's a problem. But when you say, but what about the looters? But what about the cops? Blue Lives Matter. But Trump didn't say that. When you keep saying but, you're telling me the statement before doesn't matter, because now this second sentence that you want to add is what you're focused on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he died. That's terrible. But this is not honoring his memory, because they're looting and they're destroying stuff. And then my question is, who's they? Because we're talking about a black man being killed. So now when you say they're not honoring him because they are looting, now not only are you being insensitive, now you're using a condescending argument that has no substance, because it's not just they, if you're referring to they as black people.
If you can admit that a killing was horrible, to put the word "but" after it is crazy.
That's what I'm saying.
They killed them. That's horrible. But like, what comes after "but"? Like, that's
destroying. But destroying stuff is not gonna help. Okay.
Right. Okay. You're right.
Yo, the thing and listen, if you black, white, Spanish, whatever, I don't care. It's for everybody. Stop telling us to do what Martin Luther King did, because
David, stop bringing his name up, bro.
What Martin Luther King did was great, but it also got him killed. Let's just talk about what it is. He did it peacefully, and then when he started to talk to us about real stuff,
that's when they were like, no. Like,
which is economics, which we're still lacking now, is when they still killed him. So we can think about every time we tried to build something up that empowered us. You got Black Wall Street. You got Seneca Village, right? Which a lot of people don't even know about. I was talking to Paul earlier. Mm-hmm. Everybody think that Central Park just been there this whole time, but that's not true. You got even in Pennsylvania, 1985, they had beef with a group, the MOVE.
And they killed them.
They bombed
the joint in Philly
in the middle of a block of a neighborhood.
Yep.
So that's no disregard for life. And then don't talk to me about people lying on us. And like you said, with the Karen in the park talking about the man that's threatening her life. Come on, we've seen that. We've seen that with Emmett Till. We've seen that with Central Park Five. Like it just goes on and on. Then you have people like Brock Turner, who was actually physically seen raping a girl, who's a white young boy, raping a girl, and the father said he should not do time for 2 minutes of action, and then the judge said that I'm not going to give him a sentence because I don't want to ruin this young man's future.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like people don't want to talk about those things, but you're telling me that I don't have the right to be angry. People telling me I don't have the right to be angry when Dylan Roof could go inside the church, receive prayer, and then kill them. And then the cops take him to Burger King.
Mm-hmm.
But Philando Castile is shot in his car and lets the officer know that he has a gun.
They shoot us because they're scared and, you know, they don't know what's going to happen. They think we have something and we don't even have a weapon and we die. But cops get like, I remember that, I don't know if y'all remember that, the terrorist that was around like Times Square a few years ago. They shot and hit a police officer.
Oh, with the car? They drove the car through the crowd?
Oh, no, that's even crazier. Yeah, but I'm talking about, that's even crazier. But there was, they caught these dudes, these terrorists. They were I'm not sure what Middle Eastern country they were from, but they were shooting, they actually shot the cops, but taken into custody. We die when y'all think we have a gun. Like, when we've actually pulled one out and you get shot at and still figure out a way to arrest these non-black perpetrators. But with us, as soon as you think, Tamir Rice was a 12-year-old kid, they basically did a drive-by on that little boy. Like, they drove, if you see the video, the car barely stopped moving before they were shooting him. And he had a toy gun, and he's a kid. And you mean to tell me that we, you know, these things we're bringing upon ourselves, and this is not about race, and we're just, it's ridiculous. And like you said, they won't even admit the problem that's happening. Everybody knows the quotable from Malcolm X when he says, you know, you stab me, you pull a knife out, you know, 3 inches, it's not progress. You pull it out 6 inches, it's not progress. You pull all the way out, that's still not progress. Progress is when you actually heal the wound that you inflicted, but they haven't even done that. They won't even admit there's a knife in your back, you know? Right. So, like, you know, like, how else do you want us to respond besides anger? Like, what do you, like, to take back what you said, we're human beings, like, y'all get angry? Things happen to you guys, you get angry.
Let me say something, yo. Hmm? White people are some of the most violent people in the world, bro.
What?
The most violent people in the world.
How did they build the empires that they had? With blood.
Yo, I know somebody watching this. Some of my friends that's white might see this. I'm sorry. It's the truth. I love y'all. If you're my friend and you're white, I do love y'all. I do. Trust me, I got friends of all race, creed, nationality. But I'm just telling the truth.
I mean,
look at how y'all got all these guys.
To go back to the Tupac quote of, you know what I'm saying, of the escalation of the music or, you know, the fear of us one day retaliating, truth be told, we still have it.
Nope.
Even with this level of rioting, looting, protesting, whatever you want to call it right now, that's not the revolution or an uprising or what the true fear of us doing is. Mm-hmm. They really fear that, and we have yet to, like, we are still docile creatures.
And this is life.
They are lucky of that.
This is life.
We really, you know, even let's just say, you know, if it was us, that's the mindset is just that. The mindset isn't an actual, you know, revolution overtaken. We tried that, you know, with Nat Turner, you know what I'm saying? We tried to overthrow it, and it was one dude. There's always a Judas amongst the pack to turn on, you know what I mean? So then we tried the segregation thing, and we're actually 99 years removed from the Tulsa, fires. And when they took over, you know, Black Wall Street, it was literally 99 years to the day we're recording this that went down.
Yeah.
People, like you said, Gene, a lot of people are unaware of that.
Yeah.
We had our own fully established city, mm-hmm. you know, 200 businesses, you know, a bus system, our own airport, you know, hospital.
They knew that was a blueprint. They knew that was a blueprint. That was going to start happening all over the country.
Seneca Village was first, you know, and they came up with the bright idea, let's make the biggest park in the city. Let's just take that over. You know what I'm saying? So when we do try, every time we do try to either just get away or the peaceful route, we try to abide by and appease and please, that gets taken away. You know what I'm saying? Colin Kaepernick took the knee. They said that was wrong. You know what I mean? We put a fist in the air. They said
everything's wrong, bro.
That's what's so crazy. And then when we do this, people's like, oh, why don't you peaceful protest? I gotta be honest, man. Protest not supposed to be peaceful.
you have a problem, you know.
I'm just being real. Protests are supposed to be disruptive. Like, people want things to still be, oh, don't get in the middle of the parkway because I gotta go to work. Man, forget your job. We don't care about your job. Somebody just got murdered. Right. Like, the thing is, you are, a protest is supposed to cause disruption in the organization of whichever system is oppressing the people. And that's what's been going on before all three of us have been here. And you know what? It may still go on after we're gone. Our children's children might be the ones that hopefully reap some sort of equality. I'm very hopeful for that. And again, man, I know y'all not. I'm going to continue to call it out. And like I said, when I figure out and when I get with some people and we can really do something to help make a dent in one small area, I know we're going to multiply that because we're too smart to not be able to do that. And I'm not depending on a celebrity that's right. already made it, a millionaire that's already made it. And no, nothing against them. I know they try, whatever, but sometimes they're still tied by that dollar. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. I'm not upset with them. But what I'm saying, for me, I have a responsibility as a black man, as a son, as a brother, as a husband, as a father, to do the best I can to change whatever I feel like is wrong and could have implications on my family.
So let's get some solutions. What can we do? What do you guys feel right now we can do?
Bank Black. One, there's a bank that somebody just sent me the other night. Carver? One United or United One Bank.
Oh, okay. I know
Carver. The largest national black bank.
Yeah. I think Carver is black on too, but yeah. That's good. I mean, we need to go back into doing that and trying to look into to see where we can separate ourselves so that because y'all remember y'all all remember the show Money and Violence, right? And I thought that had
from an Brooklyn?
Interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I always thought that had an interesting name because those are the two things that the regime respects. Like those are the only two things that'll make it move. When it fails, it's gonna lose some skin. Or it's gonna lose some dollars. So if we go the money route and we commit to it, we could really make a dent. Like there's a lot of I know y'all seen the July day, 7 day, whatever. They don't want money. Black people to spend any money. I personally think that's cool, but that's if we spend money on the 6th and the 8th, what was the difference with not spending on the 7th?
Right.
But if we're putting money in a black bank, like you said, right, and it becomes successful, and it makes it possible for more black banks. I'm not sure how big this United One Bank is, so let's say if it were to take on that much business, but if it can, then that's even better. But if that can then start the upstart of more black banks to where we start as a people just solely fucking with them, that'll definitely send a message. We need to stop. We need to. A good solution too, as much on a granular level, is to really start fucking with each other. You know, I think that you know, as much as black people say they love black people and all that stuff, I think we really should really start fucking with each other. Like when it even comes to buying black, it's so many standards we put on our own people's businesses that we don't care about when we shop in other places.
That's what I'm saying, bro.
You know, we'll say, well, I don't buy from him because he do this and that and that and that. He got an attitude. And no matter what y'all do,
But you keep going in that beauty supply store with the Asians that follow you around.
Exactly. Exactly. when around me, in my not so far from my neighborhood, when the Asian people beat on the that one, that girl in there, like, yeah, okay, they shut the nail shop down. But you know how many black women I sent lists of black-owned nail salons to? Like, I'm like, look, I know y'all might not know off top of your head where to find black-owned, but here you go. Here's a whole list. Bob Burrow too. So I don't want them to be a few in Brooklyn, but you live in the Bronx. You want me to come to Brooklyn? Come on now. Nah, it was some in the Bronx, some in Harlem, and Brooklyn. Quit like say, hey, you take your pick. I'm not. They do disappointment. Oh, they want to pay this for. Like, come on, bro. Let's really make a difference. Like, you know. And again, another thing that we do too that I don't like is when I ask you, if I ask you, Gene, if I tell you, hey, Paul said he only put black people on his podcast so that black people will watch his podcast. He really doesn't like black people, right? So if I say, Gene, you gonna fuck with Paul podcast after that? Now you have the right to say, yeah, I will for this reason, or no, I won't for this reason. But what I hate happens when black people do is that they give me a reason that has nothing to do with them. So I'll ask you that, and you go, well, yeah, because every time everybody else say cancel something, they cancel it for 5 minutes, and then who cares? But I didn't ask you about what everybody's going to do. I want to know why you, what are you going to do as far as that's concerned?
So prime, like, you prime know, example that you said that, right? Mm-hmm. So everybody know, Paul know, we had this conversation multiple times about Kanye, right? Mm-hmm. And people felt their way. And I was like, dag, like he's wilding out. Is that how he really think? And I was like, yo, one of the things I said is like, I can't say I'm not buying Yeezys because I don't buy Yeezys. So that has no impact on me as far as supposedly canceling mm-hmm. somebody. So what I did was, I love Kanye music. I said, all right, every time Kanye come on, I'm skipping the song, or I'm not listening right. to it. Now, what happened was Kanye did a list of interviews, and you know he's always struggled back and forth with his faith. Right. So when he supposedly came over, it seemed like he's doing good. Again, I can't be the judge, but as a Christian man, as a child of God, I support him on that front. You understand what I'm saying? I didn't stick to, oh, the sheep, yeah, well, everybody else is listening to his music. No, I stopped listening to his music. Once Kanye declared his love publicly multiple times for Christ and said he's doing his best to live his life, I'm obligated to support that brother. That's what right. I live by. Not everybody saying, oh, passionate. That had nothing right. to do with me. What actually did kill me was skipping those songs because I love Kanye music. Right. Like, I skipped those songs. Right. Like, the same thing with R. Kelly, I still don't listen to R. Kelly. And I'm going to be real. It's whack because sometimes I want to step in the name of love. You feel me? But my man's was wilding out. Yeah. I don't know when or if I will ever listen to music. And the crazy thing about it is that sometimes when you do those things, you have to really evaluate everything, because then every single thing in your life becomes, like you said, a convoluted, because there's something wrong with almost everything. That comes from somebody, because everybody's human. Now, they might not be to the scales of R. Kelly, but we could go down the list of things that we support musically, freaking food-wise, freaking clothes-wise, and find something
that we don't agree with. We'd just mm-hmm. be outside naked. We'd be having to grow our own food. We'd have to be doing a lot of different things. But, I mean, back to speaking of a solution, I mean, What we need to do is, whatever our solution is, our solution has to be big enough to influence. Because without racism is not the issue. The oppression due to the racism is the system due to the racism. Because honestly, if every white person in the world told every black person, hey, we think you're inferior, you suck. If they felt that way, but it didn't affect how we lived, and it didn't affect if we can get a job, if it didn't affect, you know, how we're policed, I'd be cool. Y'all don't like that? Big deal. But, you know, but the fact that you feel that way, but the fact that you feel that way has made you build a system now that oppresses us. The solution that we find needs to give them a reason to dismantle that. Give them a reason to see, oh, nah, we can't do this anymore, because look what it's doing to our pockets. Look what it's doing to that. Because honestly, I don't care what's in their heart, because I don't know them. I don't care about them. But, you know, I want my people to be able to live. I want people to be able to walk around and follow their dreams and not have to worry about obstacles that are not in front of everybody else. That's what I want. I don't care who likes us. You know, like, I don't really care about any of that. I just want us to have a fair shot.
I agree, obviously, 1,000% with that. And my thing is, the first thing we have to start with, before you can take action, it has to be a thought. Yeah, some people won't even get the thought because they have the wrong mindset. Right. And I hate to tell everybody, but you got to leave some black people behind because they don't know that they black.
Yeah. Oh.
Like, just like Harriet Tubman said, she could have freed a whole lot more slaves if they knew they were slaves. So, and we could help a lot more people if they knew they was in trouble.
So we know the system is...
Most people don't think that that is not... Most people think it's fair.
Yeah. We know the system is the issue, and we know... For the most part, even when we say fuck the police and all that stuff, even the police are pawns in the system. Yeah. And the problem with them is, for example, Karen in Central Park, they weaponize the police against us.
Yes. 100%.
Because they know what it could lead to. So it's like, it's one of those, I'm going to scare you with this, but if it leads to that, I'm good. That's what they're here for. And do you think, obviously it's a learned behavior, you know what I mean? But do you think it's a naivete on their part, or you think they're fully aware of...
No, 100% aware.
You think they're fully aware?
100%.
I know you just asked that question.
What when she told him, I'm going to tell them that a black person, she thought that was going to be a deterrent. She said that so that he'd be like, well, chill, don't do that, because he knows what happens when you call the police, the cops are black people. And on top of that, when you say he's threatening my life, so that was, she knew what that was. I had a conversation with somebody.
Yeah. No, I was gonna say, so it's clear that some of them are fully aware of that situation. So
all of them,
a salute.
Yeah, all of them.
I'm not gonna get, speaking of absolutes. Some are in a bubble that they're unaware. You know what I mean? Some don't really have those interactions like that.
Stay right there.
Okay.
To me, that's a choice of ignorance at this point in time. That is a choice of ignorance, because if you can put it in your mind to ignore something, you won't have to deal with it.
I don't know if it's a choice though. Like I said, they couldn't fathom our life. Like for example, she lives in, you know, Central Park West or whatever, she's still in, you know, the city. There's some rich people that don't even come to the city except for that, you know what I'm saying? So they really don't even interact with the police themselves. And it's not to say that it's a choice of ignorance. It's just not it's not something that they even care about. They don't even think about that.
So let me ask you a question. How many of them you think watch the news?
I don't know. I mean, I couldn't speak for
it would, clearly it would be like a guesstimate, right? Mm-hmm. And yeah, I hate speaking in absolutes.
Mm-hmm.
But we're in 2020 where you have access to everything everywhere.
But you have to be aware of it now. But because even watching the news, you're getting a triggered
target, yeah.
You know, so even still, they spin it either way. You're not even getting the real story on the news. So they're seeing it, especially if they watch Fox News. They're not watching, right. So they're looking at us. Fox News talks about us horribly. So watching the news, I'm saying, they're still gonna get a mindset that they really don't know what's really going on. So that's what I'm saying. I'm not shooting them bail. I'm just saying there are some that are completely oblivious. Like, it's shocking. Like, it was even at that point when the Rodney King situation happened, it was like, yo, he really did that. Like, some of them are really oblivious to this.
Well, so let's talk about like, I guess times and history then, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're talking about Rodney King. You're only about, what, the 30 years removed?
Ago, about, yeah.
30 years removed. So not to give an excuse, but again, I'm very, I like to try to look at multiple sides. That I could kind of understand with not so much access. We talking about 2020, where literally access is everywhere. And I'm not condemning them. I'm just saying, personally, to me, I love him. Like I said, I still love him. I don't hate anybody. But you have to know. You have to be aware. It's almost like being black and not knowing if you're in the wrong neighborhood at a certain time that you could be arrested just because you're black. You understand what I'm saying? Like, people would say you know better.
But we know that because we live in that. There are some people that are oblivious to it. Like, even the dude in the, like, there's some people that don't, like, going to the wrong neighborhood and stuff. Some, if you're new to the neighborhood, you don't know. That's a new, like, remember the movie The Wood? Yeah. Big Mike didn't know he couldn't wear that blue hat. He was from North Carolina. Now he in L.A. That's real. Like, you can't wear certain colors. Right. It was a new world to him. So there are some that it's a new world to them. But what I wanted to get to was that the fact that, like you said, that the availability of that knowledge is abundance now with Twitter and Instagram and people speaking a message. Now you have the choice of choosing to be aware of it. But again, you still may be in your bubble. That's a choice because it's not my problem. So there's some of those and there's others. But one solution, we need to get more allies from that side. Because we have to do something about those that are fully aware mm-hmm. of the weaponizing of the police and using that for their power, and because that's one of the biggest issues is because at the drop of a dime you can see in that video she changed her tone up, she was getting herself so riled up trying to get some tears to come out, she's jumping the dog up, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? So that has to be some sort of a crime too. False, you know, false accusations, or, you know, because you're wasting the police officer's time, and that builds to them getting frustrated.
Yeah.
And you know, so when something does come,
Brian Wolf, it has to be a fine.
So we
gotta start with a fine.
Yeah. So we need something on that, and that's minor. You know what I mean? But it would lead to the system having mm-hmm. to adjust in some sort of way. We need to push back and have some laws or something that created to have them stop weaponizing against us. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's a problem when they just keep calling on us and you know, he was calm. So he was calm.
Yeah.
He remained calm. He started recording. She's coming at him. He had it on. And now we have cell phones and things like that can assist us in those situations. We got to start using those a little bit better. And I was talking to, you know, to my cop friend, to my officer friend earlier, when we do use our phone, or if we're just watching another situation, we can't talk over it. We need to just record, and because you don't know what's going on. You don't know, like you don't know what's happening. You know what I mean? You got to just record it, and then, you know, have that can be evidence or what have you. But if you're speaking and you're yelling, now the cop has to pay attention to behind me now, and that's also what antagonizes the situation.
Yeah.
Because while he's talking mm-hmm. to this gentleman he's arresting or IDing or what have you, now you got somebody in the background, yo, y'all messed up what y'all doing. Now they start to reach for their
only
a ruckus behind.
Only thing you need to say is, officer, I just want to let you know you're being recorded,
and leave it at that, right? And all leave right. it at that, because that's part of the problem too. You know, saying we can't amp up the situation, because we get it. We know the officer's job is hard work. You know,
it's
8-hour shift.
I can't, it is.
It is.
I can't clock out. Like, I'm black 24/7.
You know? Yeah. I said that, man. Like, I said that. Like, in the midst of all of this, I said, look, I understand you have a difficult job, but it's to protect and serve. Mm-hmm. You know, and more people gotta get down to that. And Paul, you're absolutely right with the voting, man. People just wait for the presidential election, and to be honest, that's, the president doesn't affect.
That's the least important
what
one
we have going on. That's we need these local officials and councilmen that could be mayor and a council seat for 8+ years and so on and so.
Mm-hmm.
That is a reason why a lot of these laws are still affecting. And you know, well, we live in New York. I'm in Connecticut, but it still doesn't matter. We need to get these local people on our side. And I'm gonna be real. Sometimes it takes money. So one solution is a collective group of black people will get together,
mm-hmm.
get whatever money you need to do, and get these people in your pocket. Because
that's what we
guarantee
need to
you.
Because we need to, even if we put a dent or chip into the system, we need to get some kind of, you know, something vocal into the system. Mm-hmm. It's clear, we all know this, we've known it for years, that the system is the problem. You know what I'm saying? When we say fuck the police and all of that, we don't mean all of them. Everybody knows that.
Don't.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, but we said, it's not all white people, because it's every race, including black people.
Including black people. Yeah.
We want that same sentiment reciprocated. Don't look at all of us as thugs and criminals.
Yeah.
Exactly. We need that as well. If we're gonna say not all of y'all are bad, we need y'all to say the same thing. Like, y'all can't just be afraid because I'm big and black. You know what I mean? So mm-hmm. we need that same thing. You know, we need that reciprocity. You know, in those situations, like homie, that you know that shot Philando Castile or whatever. If you tell me to get my ID, let me get it. Give me the benefit of being able to, or before you just blast, tell me, put one hand out the window, reach with the other hand, or have my girl do it. Something like, if you feel, control the situation then. You know what I'm saying? There's plenty of times, you know, we know people can get amped up. Yo, why you threat that? But he was not that. You know what I'm saying? So if you tell him, listen, keep your hands up because I'm nervous. Have your girl reach in the glove compartment or whatever. Okay. All right, officer. Babe. Go get the, you know what I'm saying, it's right there, right behind the book. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Pass it over. Here you go, sir. Like, you know what I'm saying? Whatever it takes. You know what I mean? Because the burden is on the one in power. You're afraid. Yes. I'm afraid. The difference is you got body armor, a gun, backup, such a, you know what I'm saying? It's just me right now. But we both afraid. We both, like, my blood pressure goes up when the lights come on behind me. You know, for situations, for years, and they feel the same way. Like, all right, this could be the one.
I had somebody tell me that, oh, well, I get nervous when the cops pull me over too, and I'm like, man, it's for completely different reasons.
Trust me. You don't want to pay a ticket. You know your taillight is broke, so you don't want to get up. That's right. Why you're nervous.
Right.
like, come on. In full circle, like y'all said earlier, $20. We don't know if he was printing them, if he had a stack of them. It was just that one. And like I said, I spoke to my officer friend homie earlier, and I asked him, I said, you know, what is the protocol for that? And you know what I'm saying? And part of the video, because we only seen the video of him in on his, you know, on the ground, and there's another video of them pulling him out the car. But we don't know what took place when him in the store with the store clerk and then to that car situation. You know what I'm saying? But truth be told, it's like, listen, if he was unaware that the bill was fake, He was still there. He didn't run out like, oh, they got me. Like,
yo, to me, at that point, it doesn't matter because, and all right, granted, the one with the knees on his neck, we still don't even see him. Granted, not you wouldn't even try to move in that situation, but we don't even see him squirm. We don't even see he's any type cut. Of resistance. And even when he's walking to the car, which we can see that, you don't see him pulling away. Yeah. And he's walking calmly. So to me, all of that, I don't. It matters, but my mind is made up, which I'm sure you guys' mind is made up. So I don't really care. And at this point, the crazy thing is, to find out if the dollar bill was fake or real, I don't even think we should know. Because
that's why I say
if we find out that bill was real, if we find out that it was real, then now we got more stuff that we got to deal with.
Right. And
because
that's why
was it called in that it was fake?
There's missing pieces to it because, you know what I'm saying, like the protocol isn't straight up handcuffs and, you know what I'm saying, like, yo, if the bill was fake, I got it from the ATM over there or
exactly.
I got changed
right
there.
The bill could be fake. That doesn't mean that I knew it was fake.
Right. You can't. What is my charges? What am I being arrested for? Possession of a counterfeit bill? I didn't know. That's why he got. I don't have that pen. He got the pen. He it's the store.
I guess at that point you said tell it to the judge, but at the end of the day you'd have to prove that I had knowledge. But and at least there's a process there. You know what I'm saying? Like at least there's a process.
Myself, I can't speak to the judge. I thought it was $20. I thought it was $20. No, he's dead.
Right. That's one of the major problems. Like we get through the process, we're done. But we can't even go through the process now. We can't even get to the process.
Mm-hmm. And that's what I feel like that. But I'm right now. I want to try to find some solutions. I want to get something done because you know years. I mean, Emmett Till, all that we've been dealing with this for years. You know, you look up the history of the police. You know, you already know what that is. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Everything we've tried. I mean, if we can give one more chance to trying to get somebody in office, you know what I mean, on the lower scale. The problem is it's state by state. We would need a group effort from multiple locations, and that's probably one of the hardest things to do, because even when you get a little bit of power and a little mobilization, you know what I'm saying, we see what happened to the Black Panthers, we see what happened to Malcolm X. No one man should have all that power, you know what I'm saying, and that grows the fear. Then they fear us when they feel like, yo, we got a little bit of, this dude got a little control over here, you know what I'm saying?
We need, to be real, we need, like, whatever, you know, they're gonna see this and all, but we need sleeper cells, yo. Like, for real, We need some sleeper cells that's working on some productive stuff, and clearly not to harm anybody, but to be productive for our community. So that way, once we get all the efforts the right way, then boom, we can just come out and do what we need to do, bro. I know some people's like, but I know every black person is not going to be on board, and that's okay. I'm not worried about them. I'm worried about the majority that is going to be on board, that's serious about doing stuff.
I hope Jay-Z is that. I mean, he spoke to the governor. That was huge. If you know what I'm saying, if he got
the attorney general to step in.
Yeah, to step in and might even up the charges. It, you know, again, the charges is one thing that it's the way the system is created. You got to pen that. It got to be that. They got to prove that. But if Jay got involved with that, and if the governor respected whatever their conversation was, you know what I'm saying, that's huge. You know what I mean? And mm-hmm. if Jay pulled that off, that's big. And if he's that,
and we can have another conversation another day.
Back and forth about Jay and him, his, you know, saying with Kaepernick stuff.
But that's what I'm saying. We spoke about that, so we can have another conversation another day on how when he did that move, black people's like, oh, he's a sellout, this, that, and I'm like, yo, give him a chance, man, because sometimes. Before you build your own table, you gotta get a seat so you can see how the table needs to stand.
And the thing is, I stand by that.
The NFL move to me did nothing. That was a business move. But now this move, I fully respect. The NFL move to me, that was a business dude.
Right. Yeah. Now we see that NFL was just straight business. But like I said, I wanted to give him a chance.
Yeah, and I gave it to him. Like I said, I don't just jump. When I post certain things, I don't post it as it happens. I don't talk about certain things as it happens, especially now that I got this platform. Because anything I say, it's here for life. People gonna bring it back. But you said that.
Remember that,
bro.
And people are allowed to change their opinion too when more facts come out. Yo, true. You know what I'm saying? But I call Jay best lyricist. I praise Jay. I'm first hip hop billionaire. I'm all for it. To me, the NFL thing, I was like, because like we said, the way he said it about Kaepernick, I was like, man, like, and we talking about unity, like, it just came off like you just pushing him, you know what I'm saying? And Cap even was offering to pay for the protesters, to get their bail, legal, you know what I'm saying? So he stepped in. The more people involved, the better. I'm all for it. I like to see Kaepernick doing his thing. But the cause, the goal is the same, and that's all I care. I care about.
Your man Virgil from Off-White with his $30.
We gonna come right back with that.